I wanted to start, first of all, by saying I was asked to talk about my book, and there'll be plenty in my book, which I'm pleased some of you actually have. It's a long book, it's a heavy book. The paperback is a lot more transportable than the hardcover, but I didn't want this just to be about Weston as a writer, Weston as an author looking at these wars. I tried to shift my presentation to, I think it was Dr. Meyer who recommended that I spend some time on the context of how these wars kicked off. So if you do get the book, you'll get plenty of me. You'll get a lot of Iraqis, a lot of Afghans, a lot of Marines, and I think the role of civilians in these wars. Part of my bio that I also like to say is that in addition to my time in the State Department, my worst grade in college was in American foreign policy. And it wasn't a horrible grade, but it was not an A grade. And I still ended up trying to do my best in American foreign policy. And my first job was at Dairy Queen. So if any of you started at McDonald's, feel proud about it. All right, so I'm going to start with just some slides and some photos. And to make this less monologue, I'll ask a few questions along the way. The best diplomacy starts with getting to know each other. If anything, I think that what these wars have taught us, whether military or civilian, is who it was we were dealing with and who we were asking to work with us, who we were asking to collaborate with us. And I have a chapter in my book that I consider to be one of the most important, which is actually titled Collaboration. So it's us and them. Who is the other? This photo from the George W. Bush Museum in Dallas. After 9/11, the war was defined as a global war on terror. And I know some of you are pretty young in the room. And I'll spend a bit of time talking about what that context was like when Dr. Simkin and I were in New York at our mission there in the run-up to the Iraq War just after 9/11. For better or for worse, whether you agree or disagree, this was defined by the administration at the time as a global war on terror. And within that, of course, we started two wars. Anyone remember when Afghanistan kicked off? What was the date that we started bombing Tora Bora, the eastern mountain region of the Afghan-Pakistan border?
October 11th?
October 2001.
October, November, basically. It was weeks after 9/11. And then Iraq, does anyone remember when we started bombing Baghdad?
2003.
March of 2003. Did President Bush have a case on both wars? You can read my book and you'll see how I break it down. I believe Iraq was a wrong war. I believe Afghanistan was, right is a loaded word, but necessary war. President Bush, and Tom, you'll know this better than anyone, had legal authority under UN Chapter 7 resolutions on Taliban and Al-Qaeda. People forget that before 9/11, a lot of good diplomats did a lot of hard work in New York with members of the UN Security Council Sanctions Committee to get pressure on Osama bin Laden. All of a sudden, after 9/11, all of that international law authority was pre-existing. Iraq, of course, we could argue there was never Chapter 7 authority for that invasion. So when President Bush and the administration at the time, our bosses, said to the Taliban, hand over Osama bin Laden, what did they do? They didn't, right? So we started that war. What do you see in this photo? Is it possible to turn on the lights just a little bit? Because there's a helicopter in that cloud. That was taken on in Host Province in a district called Musakel. And I put that one up there because, of course, Americans are going back to Afghanistan. But those kids are now 10 years older. What do you see in that photo? Yeah, for anyone who spent any time in the wars, I think HESCO, which is Hercules, et cetera, company, it's a great name, made a fortune on HESCO barriers, which is big containers filled with sand. That's check ECP-1 outside of Fallujah. And these are all my photos. That's ECP-1, so the copyright is okay. That's ECP-1 outside Fallujah. And that, I think, speaks to the kind of fight that the Marines and some of our Army were in at the time. Very much burned, very much barricaded. You know, that was between Fallujah 1 and Fallujah 2. What about that photo? Yeah, do you remember the purple finger?
Mm-hmm.
That's an actual election inkwell, bottle, whatever, from Fallujah. You can see the date on it. And we'll talk about the elections a bit as to what the political track and the political plan was in Iraq, which our military strategy was ideally and theoretically reinforcing, that the goal after the invasion was to get a new government that had buy-in from the Shia, the Sunni, and the Kurds. I can talk a lot about what worked and a lot of what didn't work in that regard. That's a pull inside in Fallujah from January 2005. So the Marines were ordered to clear the city with some British troops and some US soldiers as well. Why? Negroponte, my boss at the time, said, you know, we need to clear the city, not just to get rid of the terrorists, but to provide opportunity to vote. Right, so we talk a lot about Al-Qaeda, Zarqawi, the real terrorist threat in Fallujah, which was very much the case, but the overriding prime directive from our government was the political process. And we can spend a lot of time, and Keith, please weigh in on this, because you were in Ramadi before I arrived in Fallujah, whether or not they were in sync or out of sync. What do you see in that photo? Us and them. Okay, the Marine with his rifle, Iraqi military aged males. And for any of us who lived these wars, for most of the wars, we were describing Iraqis of a certain age as military aged males. Does anyone remember which general changed that? We had a general in Baghdad who finally said, stop calling them all military aged males. I was a military aged male at the time, I'm too old now, but I used to say, if I was called a military aged male, you know, just because of my age, it was sort of just profile me in one way. It was General Corelli. General Corelli, finally, with a very good political advisor at the time, I plotted with. We finally kind of were trying to change the language of how we were describing the Iraqis. They were military-aged males, but they were also unemployed youth, right? So there's a couple different ways of looking at how we define the people that we're working with. That's a character in my book, and I put that slide in to just show that, again, another part of the strategy in Iraq in the early days was to build up our partners. He was a highway patrolman named Waleed, and that's he's in Long Beach now. That's Colin, who was a civil affairs officer in the Marine Corps. Us and them working together, ideally. But of course, if you work with the Americans after an invasion, it's a very high-risk proposition. I speak about that and write about that in my book.
He's now in Long Beach, you said?
Colin, the Marine is. Waleed is now a father. We used to talk up through last fall, and last time I heard is that his father passed away in outside Fallujah. He was working for the Ministry of Interior on the border between Iraq and Syria, or Iraq and Jordan, and he was going back into the ISIS-controlled territory. I haven't heard from him since, so I hope he made it. What do you see in that photo?
Destroyed building.
Yep, that's what a big JDAM or something will do, and now you, I'll have you introduce yourself at some point, but that's what hard power can do, especially in a place like Fallujah. The gentleman, and I took this photo after he said, Mr. Kale, let's walk through Fallujah. And this is, battle's sort of still going on, but he ended up becoming one of our chief partners. And what he was saying in a very sophisticated way, without preaching or, you know, pointing a finger, is he said, this was my home. So Engineer Fauzi knew that there were terrorists in Fallujah. He knew there was a problem. But he also walked me several blocks outside of the CMOC, Civil Military Operations Center, to show me that's his house. He still worked with us. And so when I was in California recently speaking, and I asked people, you know, where would you draw that line? Could you still work with the Iraqis outside LA? You know, they said they were here to help, and, you know, your neighborhood looked very different. Right or wrong, good or bad, we'll talk about that. What do you see in that photo? That's humanitarian aid. That's, you know, November, December of 2004. battle basically had quieted down a lot, although we had some episodes that were very serious that were still going on. A lot of razor wire between us and the people, and that didn't really ever change. Got a little bit better, but you know, if you see my book, you get a better, clearer picture of the eyes, and often, you know, the eyes will tell you a lot. And we were doing our best to try and welcome the civilians back in, but if you see behind, that's what the streets look like, at least about half the city. More razor wire, Marine friend of mine, women lined up, you know, you got the quote military age male going the opposite direction, more razor wire. What do you see in that photo?
Bad technique.
Looks like Phoenix on a Saturday night.
Yeah, for Phoenix on Saturday night. You said bad tactic, Keith, what do you mean by that?
Well, putting people down in the dirt like that is going to last a long time in their world.
Yeah, I'll tell you the background. Then Colonel Nicholson and I, who was a regimental commander, he's now in charge of our Marines in Okinawa, Japan, were out going a lot of different places. And I took that photo because we had just met with the tribal sheikhs, and they said, our sons are becoming part of what became the awakening. The MARSOC Marines, I think they were MARSOC special, went in after we had left and found all these weapons. And so too, they're trained if Iraqis have weapons that shouldn't belong there, you know, they're gonna take care of the problem. So it shows you that both were acting sort of how we were trained. General Nicholson and I said, these guys are actually part of the solution, and we picked them up, dusted them off, took the, you know, the ties off their hands. But I put that one up there because this was showing the shift that was going on at the time from military age male threat to Sahwa awakening, and also to show that when you get a large military footprint in an environment, this happens all the time. And Keith, you, I'm sure, saw that a lot in the body. Whether or not they, you know, stayed on our side or not, we also paid a lot of money at the time when the awakening started to happen. What do you see in that photo?
Biometrics.
Biometrics. So Preston, he was our chief of staff, and Helen, what do you mean biometrics?
Well, one of the things is you're trying to determine who's who, who's supposed to live there. Some places don't have a national identity card or very poor national identity card.
Right, so we brought 21st technology into Fallujah, and we were fingerprinting, and we were saying, line up and we're gonna scan your iris. They're all about the same age, but we were trying to determine who was who and if there were records that we could locate. But I also put that up there because that's also a pretty, I think, stark reminder of we ain't in Kansas anymore, you know, and we were trying to do our best to maneuver through the minefield of just who was an insurgent, who was Al-Qaeda, and whether the IRS, you know, files helped us with that, I'd have to defer to other people. That photo is a escalation of force incident. And in my book, I try and remind us that there's a human cost in these wars. My book is not a big policy, strategic frame. It's a bottom-up, ground level. And this story, a young girl was wounded in an escalation of force incident. Marines were trained to, if a car was coming toward a checkpoint, it was a threat. And I think this was the year that General Miller was the deputy commanding general. And General Miller, I used to go out with him to the checkpoints, and General Miller was very blunt about, you know, you're going to have to take on some risk. This is what happens. And now I'm sure you had a lot of conversations with the Marines and Helmut too, that there's a line here that if it's a threat, you got to protect yourselves, but, you know, civilian casualties also come at a cost. She ended up being okay, but we took her to the base to get treated, and she told me, I don't want to go back to Fallujah. And I said, well, it's your hometown. You know, and I was talking through an interpreter. And her brother, his eyes, I think, show that side of the story. But she said, I feel more safe on your base than I do in Fallujah, which shows you kind of where we were. What do you see in that photo? Or what do you think you see? Each of their fathers was assassinated. So when I talk about when you come into these war zones and you ask the local population to work with us, whether you're a Marine leader or a civilian, like me, certain leaders stand up, and they have loaded agendas, and they have interests, and they have sensitivities and they have allegiances that are very mixed. The son on the left, his father was a deputy police chief. He was assassinated, shot about 8 times on the left, the right side of the vehicle. The one in the middle, his father was the last, the Grand Mufti of Fallujah, Sheikh Hamza, which I'll talk about in one of my case studies. And then to the right was Sheikh Kamal's son, who was the city council chairman. In that meeting, Abbas, who was the English teacher in Fallujah, helped me hand over $5,000 in fresh cash, courtesy of the US taxpayer, to say to them, we wish, you know, your government were doing this, which is what one of them said. The money was coming from the Americans. They wish the Iraqi government was saying, your father is a martyr. And why did we pay blood money? Why did we pay Salacia, or however you want to call it? Why would we pay money to them? You know, General Petraeus, money is a weapon system. I agree with that. It has limits, but we were at least trying to show, and they didn't want to take the money. And you can see it in their faces. It was kind of dirty money to them. It's from the Americans. But why did they take it? They needed to take care of their families. So I write a lot about what that dynamic is like. What do you see in that photo? Has anyone been to Habaniya? Old British military base from like 1920s, and we were back in the same neighborhood. That's Iraqi army soldiers. We were on the back of a Humvee, and Dave Meadows was with me, Habib Yusuf. That's an Iraqi army graduation. And I put that one in there to show that's really obviously who is best suited to fight security in Iraq, right?
What year was that picture
taken? It was taken, I want to say 2005. It may have been 6, but I think it was 5. Before I left in 07, so I believe it was mid-05. General Zimmer was our general at the time. That's Iraqi KIA in Fallujah. That's part of the 93 we lost just in and around Fallujah in 1 year, in 2006. So when people say, well, you've been in Helmand, you've been in Host, you've been in Fallujah, you've been in parts of Ramadi, what was the hardest? I always say 2006 in Fallujah. I don't know if you lived through 2006 in Iraq, but it was the worst. And we lost a lot of young Marines and soldiers in just a very, very limited space. When we got to Helmand, when Preston and Mel were there, we had, what, a 200 square kilometer AO, and we only moved by helicopter. There, we were always moving by Humvee. And that, I think, is also part of what I'm trying to bring across in my book, that obviously when you go to war, casualties are gonna happen, civilians are gonna get hurt, and we should think about what the strategy is before we get to that point. What do you see in that photo? That's Secretary Rumsfeld. He visited us in, that's Camp Fallujah, in December of 04. So Al-Fajr, the big battle in Fallujah, was still going on, but that's the Lava Dogs out of Hawaii. And one of their, 1-3, I think, and one of their first deployments actually into a combat zone happened in Iraq. I put that one in there because I do try in my book look at accountability issues and more. Myself on the ground, our operational units on the ground, but also a political frame, which is obviously we have war cabinets who decide when we go to war, how we go to war, and then what some of those policies are once we're at war. And that's true today. What do you see in that one?
Secretary.
That's a congressional delegation to TQ, to Cotton, I believe. So Pat Carroll and I went over with General Johnson to brief Senator Kerry at the time, Senator Warner, and Senator Stevens. And I put that in there, and I've got a chapter in my book, which was a fairly risky chapter to put into my book, but I did want to show what is it like when the politicians show up in a war zone. And you can be a judge of whether I sort of succeeded in that. But I wanted to show what, you know, if you're charged with voting yes or no on the authorization of the use of military force, what is the AUMF? Anyone want to say, you're nodding your head, what's the AUMF?
It's kind of being used as the blanket. You can go do whatever you want, wherever you want.
Can everyone hear you? Speak louder if you could.
It's like a blanket authorization to use force, basically, anywhere you see terrorist threat.
Correct.
Or you say that you see terrorist
threat. So after 9/11, there were two tracks, which I'll spend some time on. There was the international track in terms of where Tom and I were at our mission in New York, Chapter 7, Allies, the British, who's going to go into Iraq with the Americans? And then we had already had the pre-existing Port Authority under the Taliban resolutions, and Osama bin Laden was named in those resolutions before 9/11. And then people forget. But the George W. Bush administration, and yes, Karl Rove, did not initially, I think, want to take a vote to Congress. I'm only speaking as J.K. Weston here. I can understand maybe the complications of taking the case to the world, but I always felt, at a minimum, you know, you should be trying to make the case to the American people through their elected representatives. What was going on, and Dr. Meyer wanted me to talk more about this, what was going on politically in 2003 in Washington? What were the Democrats saying about the Iraq War? You guys live in Washington, I'm right. Far away, but what were they saying?
Not happy about it.
Were they? How many spoke up against the Iraq War? That's what I would have thought too if I
had stayed through the year, but they shot it out positive.
It was a one big hell of a bandwagon. Yeah. And I think really the only senator that I remember who stood up was the West Virginia senator who passed away named
Robert Byrd.
Yeah.
John Kerry, Hillary Clinton.
It was a steamroll
into war. And we need to remember that. Right or wrong, good or bad, we're all adults. We can read and come to our own decisions. But people forget that there was a big bipartisan view about Iraq. There were some exceptions, but overall, not much. And that's important political context because war is inherently a political decision, right? WMD, I can talk about in the debate about that, but I put that one up there because I am in Washington and I do think that often we don't think about accountability enough. And my book tries, I hope, to do a little bit of that. What do you see in that photo? And Mel and Preston will know that better than anyone. Where is that? You remember?
Nowzad.
It's above Nowzad. And I took that photo. General Nicholson were flying to Nowzad, and this is in, Mel, I think you had left by then.
Yeah.
Actually, you had. And I used to tell friends and family in Colorado and Utah, it's like Mordor. And they wouldn't believe me. And then they saw the photo and they're like, it is like Mordor. So why would I put that photo in this brief? What's beyond being Mordor? Like, why do you think, what's the message I'm trying to convey here?
The geography,
the challenge, right? And if that ain't the limit of our military empire, what is? You know, and I think President Trump, during the campaign, was sort of thinking, why the heck would we send troops to the outer reaches of a place like that? There's an argument, maybe yes or no, or why, but I put that up there just to show where we were by the surge time when President Obama surged. We did have Marines reaching out into very, very, very distant places. And I think as a people, and when we talk about public opinion, we Americans should think about, you know, is it in the US national interest to have 20,000 Marines in Helmand or only 300 Marines in Helmand? And you know, we can all talk about those questions.
What part of Iraq is this?
That's northern Helmand. In Nowzad near Sengen, where we had 34 double, triple amputees after Preston, you and I left. There were some things I wish I'd done differently on that part of that. What do you see in that photo? That's host province, so that's not Helmand. But that spring, is that an easy or hard place to fight?
It's hard.
Yeah, for the infantry guys, it was very, very hard. Civilians in the middle. I put that up there because I think often we think Afghanistan is just this desolate desert, but where the water is actually, what do you see in this photo? Friends or frenemies or enemies?
They're in a Afghan National Police truck.
They are. It's a Ford. Do they make Fords in Afghanistan? No. So who's providing the Ford trucks? United States of America. These are what we call Artakai. I took that photo in as Musa Hill District. I used to play volleyball with them and jungle ball, but they were the Artakai, the local protectors, the sons of the tribal leaders. Do they look there like they're pretty convinced that the Americans are here to stay or that we're the best partner in the world? Not really, right? as we left, that district was very much contested with the Taliban. And I put that photo up there just to show that, again, it's less about what we're able to do and sustain. It's more about what our partners on the ground are prepared to do or to sustain. I don't know what those guys are doing now. I don't know if they're fighting with the Taliban. I don't know if they're still a member of the local Arbatai / police force. I hope that at least half of them are, or maybe 60% are on the government side, but I bet it's about 50-50. Why would I put a photo like that up there? I took that photo outside a medical clinic in Host Province as well, about a decade ago.
It's future of Afghanistan.
Future of Afghanistan.
Status of women.
Sorry?
Status of girls and women.
Status of girls and women. When we go to war, is it all just about bullets and bombs? We say that girls' education is important. And have we been saying that pretty much since 2001? Whether it was President George W. Bush or President Obama or maybe President Trump in the next while. There's a moral dimension of American power, whether you agree with it or not. Part of my job in Host was to spend $53 million of US tax dollars with the PRT commander, who's a Navy nuclear submarine commander who was very good and effective at his job, to do projects like that, to build girls' schools. In the course of 1 year, we probably funded at about $200,000 to $400,000 each, maybe say 40, 50 schools. If half are still functioning, we're lucky. But should the American people care about that? Should policy reflect that dimension of our commitment, of our public message? I don't know. And I think, you know, to the credit of First Lady Laura Bush, she made a big focus on girls' education, and the Afghans remember that. I think the current mood in our country may be less about that and more about us, right? You know, it's tricky, but are we prepared to foot the bill and to put the Marines and soldiers and airmen and others on the ground to ensure that that's part of the future of Afghanistan? Which leads me to that photo. What do you see in that one? Blue school uniforms. What are blue school uniforms? You know, part of that building the next generation of leaders. This is a project, I took the photo again about a decade ago. Do you see any Americans in that photo? Is that important or not? I took the photo, so I'm sort of off the side, but the gentleman with his arms crossed is the local education director. And what he did in that room, this is a that room that we're in was built by the Taliban. It was my favorite. I talk about this in the book. That compound reflected every foreign power that had ever been in Afghanistan because we all built the building. And the Taliban had the best design, which was just open and gardens around it. And ours was kind of this one in the corner that was sort of dumpy and fast and we overpaid for it. But these are the sons of Taliban fighters. And I worked with the education director to say, well, you know, if their fathers have reintegrated back, these are like company commander level, if they're reintegrating back into Afghanistan, their kids, if they want to be in school, they want to fit in. And so all we did is got about $7,000 approved to buy school uniforms for the sons. And what the education director said is, welcome back to Host. Whatever your fathers did, we're not going to hold it against you. And eventually we actually had some of the daughters come in too. Some of the best money I think we spent. How much does a drone cost? I mean, those of you in the business, I mean, how much does a HIMARS cost now?
Well, it's about $115,000 per round.
Okay, so $150,000 per round. It's a balance. I think we need the HIMARS in some cases, and I think we need a lot of more blue school uniforms in most cases. Mm-hmm. What about that photo?
Generations.
Sorry?
Generations.
Okay, generations. So you've got on the left the young kid in the blue school uniform. This is at a school opening ceremony that we did, and right literally on the Pakistan border, not far from Miramshaw, actually. And on the right, you've got the elder who probably remembers our effort against the Soviets, right? And what's missing in the middle? Military age male, or however we want to define it. This is one of my favorite photos because, in my view, it encapsulates the challenge. The older guy remembers the U.S. effort during the Soviet era. The young kid's too young to sort of probably have one view or another, but he's in school. And who's missing in the middle? The ones who are going to fight the government or us, or maybe look for a better future. College students at house, I'm going to try and speed up here so we have time for Q&A. I've got a whole chapter on what is it like to meet with host university students once or twice a week per year. When the ambassador came and visited, I said, here's going to be your reality check, because it was mine. I came from most parts of Afghanistan. I still get emails from them, and I'll integrate some of those into this later on. But they were the best teachers for me, because when you're in a palace, when you're in a relationship with a prime minister or a governor, do you think the governor's going to challenge the American, whether it's my level or the ambassador, very often? Tom, what do you think?
No.
It'll often be the official formal line. In your own studies in this, Daniel Morgan, you know, what I like about being in the educational environment is that often you're going to get the real thinking, the view of the street. Is the American effort working? Is it backfiring? What do they think about the government? So after the meeting, Ambassador Wood said, well, I sure earned my salary today. And I said, well, the Madrasa students are next. And then he was really going to earn his salary. That's a kid in a refugee camp. You know, I put that up there because fundamentally this is about, I think, the people who live the wars day to day. You know, our war front is their home front. They never get a redeploy. I mean, I always knew eventually I'd go to the Rockies and do something else. But this photo, have any of you read my book or parts of it? That's Dilawar of Yakazi. He was a detainee before Abu Ghraib. And I hope if you do get my book, or at least if you're bored one night and Google, you should read his story. I think it shows what can go wrong in war zones and how we try and, you know, look at that up front and acknowledge it. He was tortured to death in 5 days. What do you recognize? It's General Nicholson and I visiting Bethesda. We've seen that photo. A lot of amputees. Most of these, I believe, Marines were wounded in Helmand. And again, I try and look at what the human cost of war is, not just from the Iraqi, the Afghan side, but also from our side. The Marine on the left is doing well in North Carolina right now, but you can see it's a long-term consequence of war. Now to my book. The title of my book, and I'm sorry, your name.
I'm not
Hayden. No, what's your name?
Hayden.
Hayden said the title of your book is kind of different and interesting. It's called The Mirror Test, America at War in Iraq and Afghanistan. I based that title on the story of Aaron Mankin here. And he was a Marine I met in Fallujah before he was badly wounded and disfigured in a huge roadside bomb. When the new Marines would come in, part of my job was to say, here's the political laydown in Fallujah, here's the tribal dynamic, here are the religious leaders that you should not raid their homes, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Aaron was a public affairs Marine, and he was pretty badly wounded. So the mirror test is actually a medical term. And what it means is when doctors look at patients and say, when are they going to be ready to sort of, on their own, look at how their new appearances. And Aaron is very eloquent in his own words, and I subsequently got to know him pretty well after, these 14 years. He was only ready to look in the mirror when his younger brother and sister were about to show up in the hospital. And he didn't want them to be sort of the mirror. And I apply that rather successfully or not, in terms of sort of the larger test, I think, that we should look at as far as citizens about these wars. And it's, I stretched the metaphor, but I think overall it was a useful frame. So over 600 pages, I try and bring in these stories that show where some of the cracks are, where some of the hard stories are, but also some of where the things that worked are. That's Ramadi recently. That's an AP photo, so that's not my photo. But that's Ramadi just a few weeks ago. And that shows you sort of the resilience, actually, even in a war zone. I don't know how many times that city's been cleared or taken over by terrorists, and then good guys, bad guys. But they're back in school. Now, quickly, those are the places I've been, the perspective I represent: State Department, Fallujah, Anbar, Host, and Helmand. My job was to implement. It was not to sit in high-level meetings in Washington. Those are very, very hard jobs. We also had hard jobs on the ground. The joke that, you know, we used to have is that I was like a commissar, and Keith, when you were in Ramadi, you were like a commissar. What is a commissar? Who started the whole commissar model? Soviets. So what was the job of a commissar? To tell the military, we're watching, you know, that this is our strategy. And I had that quote down there because when I left the embassy, when we handed sovereignty back to the Iraqis, Ambassador Negroponte, who had been my boss in New York, said, "Kale, make sure the generals understand you work for me." And I thought, well, Roger, but they should know that, right? But it was very good advice because he knew that there needed to be that separation. And Mel and Preston, you can tell me, but I think when I arrived in Helmand, a lot of the staff, I think, thought, oh, Kale and General Nicholson are just buddies and they're always going to, you know, agree on everything. But when policy works or doesn't work, I think it depends on a healthy balance between the political mission and overriding objectives and then our military tactics on the ground. And I can tell a story about Helmand in terms of election support when I arrived. So I kind of love that poster now. I'm not sure I was ever that scary, but that was what Keith was in Ramadi and what we were trying to do on the ground. Okay, quickly. When I say United States of America, what words come to mind? I'll come back to this. So just think of three or four. You know, US of A equals what? Right? Now if this room were full of Iraqis, Afghans, Tom, you're a Japan expert, Japanese citizens, Brazilians, Canadians for that matter, Nigerians, whatever it is, I'm going to ask you the same question. US of A, what words would they raise their hand and say? Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Two parts. Because I'm going to come back to the pop quiz. My mom was a fifth grade school teacher. She always taught me valuable pop quiz. The Iraq and Afghanistan wars, I think I've talked a bit about the context in terms of what was going on in New York at the UN. Domestically, in terms of public opinion, in terms of Republicans and Democrats. We can go into more detail on that if you would like, especially if you're part of the sub-30 age group, maybe. But I also want to talk about how this is done on the ground. Lots of different moving parts. I added part of my brief last night because I wanted to refocus on this debate in Washington today, which is about hard power and soft power. I don't know if anyone's ever coined that, but I think hard power is relatively easy to demonstrate. Soft power is hard. If it hasn't been coined, I'd trademark it, because I believe it, that, you know, when we have a mass of military might, it's pretty clear when we shift our fleets. It's pretty clear, you know, when we send in the 1st Marine Division to a location or the 82nd Airborne. But what do we mean with soft power, and why do I believe that's harder? And then if I have time, I'll talk about allies. Case studies I'm going to end with and make sure we have time to do Q&A. I chose three from my book. You're going to get more than you ever wanted if you ever read my book, but I chose them pretty carefully. I want to talk about one in Fallujah, I want to talk about one in Host, and one in Helmand. Those are kind of a brief outline. And then at the end here, I want to kind of circle us back to maybe what have we learned from these wars, or what should we be thinking about as far as themes, limits, successes, failures. So if you're okay with that outline, I'm just going to quickly go to some of these quotes. And the second one down, I'm going to read out loud, because I don't think we have time to go through all of them. America has two fundamental powers. One is the power of intimidation. I was part of it, and America will defend herself and our idea, this experiment that we call America. And that's all it is an experiment in democracy. But the other power, I think, that perhaps we have used less in recent years, last 20 years maybe, is the power of inspiration. And I think that the power of inspiration of America at times has got to be employed just as strongly. Does anyone, Preston, you can answer this, but does anyone know who said that? Anyone want to guess?
I thought you did.
I wish. No. I'm not that
eloquent. That's not wrong.
I'm definitely not that eloquent on the spot. This was during the Senate confirmation hearing. It was Secretary Jim Mattis. He said it during the Senate confirmation hearing. Which is really, if you're bored one night, late one night on Wednesday night. You know, read his full testimony. It's very, very interesting. That was a part that really jumped out at me. In my book, actually, Keith, yes, at the end, I talk about the power to inspire. The rest of the quotes, I think, are interesting, too. But I think for us today, it's a good insight into Secretary Mattis. And today, there was a piece in the New Yorker that just came out by Dexter Filkins on Secretary Mattis. If you haven't read it, very much worth reading. And I think unless you read more than 5 articles a month, you can read it for free. It's a very good piece about the play today.
When was the first quote? Who said the first quote?
That's a quote from a book called The Allure of Battle. I reviewed it for Proceedings, and it's Cathal Nolan, which I think is also a great quote.
Because that's more a modern outcome of war, not a traditional outcome.
Right, and he makes the case in The Allure of Battle that, you know, this idea that heroic generals and our troops are in any country, that big battles generally don't, you know, determine the outcomes. And it's a 700-page book, but it's, if you're really into like real serious treatment of warfare, I would highly recommend it. The third one, does anyone know who said that? It's not American. Tom, it was one of our colleagues in New York that had that above his desk, you remember? That's Nasser, which I put up there for.
We just had a book review by one of our professors, Mike Sharmoff, who mentioned that quote.
Yes. Yeah, I remember when Dave had it above his desk in New York, and I was 29 or something, but I it was a healthy reminder. What about war is mainly a catalog of blunders? That's Churchill. And then the next one, the Arab respected force a little, et cetera, et cetera. Who does that sound like?
T.R.
You can search troops and equipment, but you can't search trust. That's General Larry Nicholson to the Washington Post, which is a great quote. So we're in the process now of increasing troop levels, maybe. But how does American trust get demonstrated? And then the last one, diplomacy is the patriotic art of lying for one's country. Do you agree with that, Tom?
Absolutely. Or not.
You say yes, you say no. Okay. That's from a writer that disappeared in Mexico. Okay, I think we've covered this already, but I wanted to put the slide up there just to, if we want to come back to the context in 2003, 2001. I also wanted to remind us what it was like in 2001. Had we had the mortgage meltdown? No. Were we an overstretched military in terms of Marines and soldiers and airmen and even Navy men out on the ships on their 4th, 5th, 6th tours? Had civilians like Keith gone to Ramadi yet? No. We're all Americans. Putin, the attacks are barbaric, and he promised all kinds of cooperation. Cuba offered medical assistance. Soccer fans in Iran, moment of silence. It's helpful and important to remember that because for all of us who lived it, it's sort of in the back of our minds. But for younger people, we were at the height of options and the height of hard power. We did not have 150,000 troops in Iraq. We did not have, at the height of the Afghanistan war, 100,000 troops. We did not have this notion of PTSD among our troops. We did not have a mortgage meltdown in 07 that like shook everything. We did not have the political dynamic in terms of these wars, you know, whether you agree with them or not. President Trump, what are his war policies? You guys live in Washington full time, I'm just a visitor. What are his war policies? We don't know, right? We don't know yet. So I know Secretary Mattis and General Dunford and Secretary Tillerson and General McMaster are all putting forward some ideas. We don't know what the war policies are. What did President Trump say yesterday? I believe it was yesterday. I watched the airport in Saudi Arabia. Any of you watched that?
Yeah.
If you haven't, it's worth watching. Do we have strategic continuity between presidents and administrations or not?
No.
Frank, you say yes? Okay, so walk us through Iraq and Afghanistan between administrations. Where was continuity between Bush and Obama on Iraq?
Well, there was some discontinuity. The most continuity has been with Afghanistan. With Iraq, there was a break.
Right. So then State Senator Obama in Chicago said the Iraq war But then he said, it was a disaster, but he said, or we shouldn't do it. Then he said, I'm not against all wars. So to shorthand it, Obama came into office saying that the forgotten war, Afghanistan, needed to be the priority, right? Remember? Bush, you know, in terms of the surge, said, you know, we can't give up here yet. Who made the decision to pull out of Iraq? It's a trick question. But who made the decision to pull out of?
The agreement was signed in the Bush administration.
Yes, there was a status of forces agreement, right, that we needed to get legal immunities for our troops, and the Iraqis would not give it. But I also like to think that it's a really, you know, inside baseball debate. But the Iraqis, you know, I used to tell my boss, Ambassador Ford, you know, Robert, we need to be sure that we're not going to lose our ability to leave. Because once the sovereign government, the president or the prime minister stands up and says, thank you, Uncle Sam, thank you, United States, is an American president able to stand up and say, but we're going to stay? This is where we were getting in Iraq, and I think this is where we're getting in Afghanistan, in terms of, we like to think we're always going to determine our entry and our exit, but there are domestic political dynamics that are extremely tricky and complicated. Ghani, you know, Hekmetyar is back. The Shia government in Baghdad with real Iranian ties and influence. You know, so what war taught me is that even as a superpower, there are inherent domestic politics in a country that we always don't see clearly, and that we always don't really have a final say on. I think it was the Iraqis, by not providing immunity, that said, okay, and whether we pushed hard enough, people who were involved at that level, and they had different views about whether we could have pushed harder as far as a follow-on troop presence. I'll go quickly through this. You know, there's a lot of people and levels involved in both of these wars. You know, Tom and I in New York were working UN issues, Security Council issues. I represented this on the Al-Qaeda Taliban Committee, which was a real eye-opener for me in terms of 15-member governments, each of whom had a veto, unlike the proper Security Council, where only five did. You got national leaders in the NSC, and going to the NSC after today to talk to a friend of mine who's surviving there. War cabinet, Congress, the citizenry, regional alliances, unions, public opinion, and then the bottom line, the implementers, right? Who actually kind of, like those of us who live the wars on the ground. So you have the higher level resolutions, war cabinet debates, and then you've got what happens on the ground. The how of US policy, hard power. Tom, you may know Admiral Pruer. He was in China.
Yes.
You probably do.
I dealt with him briefly when he was ambassador to China. He was very distinguished. Public servant.
Under President Clinton, we had an admiral turned ambassador, which has parallels today, you know, generals becoming civilian leaders. And he had a poster or a picture above his, I think it was in his study or his office, with a big aircraft carrier. And underneath it said 80,000 tons of diplomacy, which is actually true, right? Our military hardware, our military might, is a function of that big stick. Quickly, this is New York Times data, but I wanted to go over it. This is hard power. This is where the United States grabs everyone's attention. You look at troop levels and budgets, you know, that's the budget flow. President Trump wanted $60 billion. I think it's about 18 now that finally got, well, he'll be working this a lot. But you can see, you know, interestingly, during the Iraq and Afghanistan wars, the money levels. What do you see in that photo? A lot of big dots. Who's the big green one on the left?
U.S.
The United States. That's $596 billion plus about $18 billion. 55, who's that?
Russia, Britain.
So Britain, Great Britain, below France. What about the $87 billion plus a big influx, it looks like, coming down the pipeline? The Saudis. India. What about 215 and 66?
China,
Russia, and then Japan off to the right. Number of active duty US Army soldiers and Marine. My dad and uncles were all in Vietnam. They were part of that spike. And then look at the Iraq kind of bump. What was the height of US forces in Vietnam?
Half a million.
The height in Iraq? 150,000, give or take. What about the height in Afghanistan? 100,000. What are we talking about now? Increasing by?
Couple thousand.
Anywhere between a couple, maybe 3,000-4,000. Yeah. So the U.S. total presence would be what in Afghanistan if General Nicholson? Around 10,000. When I was in eastern Afghanistan, we were about, I believe, 15,000 U.S. troops. Nukes, I was talking about the nuclear, that's interesting in the sense, I think, of the spike, Cold War era, mutually assured destruction. Has gone down significantly, but it doesn't take much to do a lot of damage, right?
But that includes tactical nukes, not just strategic nukes.
I think that's all. Okay. Although tactical nuke is an interesting concept, right?
But the U.S. would show more if they could use strategic nukes.
Yeah, good point. So, because we have much higher than the Russians on the 7 other countries combined would be, who would be the other nuclear powers? Pakistan,
India,
Israel,
North Korea,
France,
Britain,
North Korea.
Yeah.
Aircraft carriers, that's the current lay of the land. We've got 10, we want 2 more. The Chinese just built their own, I think they're proud about, and then the rest along the bottom. U.S. force laydown, a lot of dots, some big ones, some small ones. A big mill map. I talked about what it was like to have, Marines in places and soldiers in places in both of these wars. And then the other side of it, which is, what is soft power? When we say soft power, what do we mean?
Diplomatic,
right? Economic projects. Facebook. Google, all that. I got this email after the Moab was dropped, almost as it was dropped, because he's living in Angar. Actually, that one I got when Neil Armstrong was passed away, and I'll show you in the next slide the other one. So in 2012, I was writing my bunker, about to get a book deal, I think, and I got out of the blue an email from Jamshid in Angar, and he wrote, so sad about the death of Neil Armstrong. He was the real pioneer who had shown his heroism and persuaded human to seek and try and more, and has made clear that nothing is impossible. And what I loved about that email is the only person who marked the passing in my world, my life, was an Afghan living where Osama bin Laden used to spend time in Angar. And I put that in my book. Some critics liked it, some didn't, whatever. But I wanted to because my dad was in Vietnam when Apollo 11 happened. And I think it's a great reminder and example of hard and soft power. I mean, my dad used to tell me that he was on a plane taking a prisoner to Long Biên, I think. And he could hear the static in the background, that they landed. Well, what was going on, 60,000 miles below the Vietnam War? And when we planted the flag, what was the message? We come in peace from all mankind. Interesting contrast. But this reminded me that even in a place like Angar, this guy was still saying there's a nation that speaks for sort of that larger. I'm still waiting for a president who has a picture of what Earth looks like from the moon, because I think that would put some things into perspective, right? So when the Moab was dropped in 2017, this is what I received. From Afghans. That's from Jamshid at the top. The most biggest bomb is being used in Nangarhar. People are shaked. We want that America destroy ISIS and terrorism, but they're destroying us. Are we ISIS and terrorists? This is all, verbatim. One of the guy whose father died in the Afghan army, one brother encounter firing in Helmand, his other brother slaughtered by Taliban, commented, "Today I realize why Taliban killed my family." Whether this is all true or not, it just seems good to you based on what I received. Please remind your government to study Afghans' behavior. Afghans can kill his brother, but can't stand a single slap from others' hand. What was former President Karzai's reaction? He condemned it and used it to attack Ghani. And then I received an email on the 2nd of May, which is, what are the reactions and response of people in government of the U.S. about using the bomb? What was the reaction in the U.S. about the Moab? Anything?
Yeah.
Nope.
Not much, right?
Nothing.
I did receive another email which I need to, that said that some of the people in Engahar were like, they needed to bomb the bad guys. But overwhelmingly, it was, wait a minute, you know, what kind of signal are you sending? Whether it was right or wrong, I don't know. But that was overwhelmingly the message I received. Back to the issue of who we work with. Our strategy today in Afghanistan is what? I mean, it's being reexamined and looked at, but what is our strategy? For those of you who've lived in Afghanistan, raise your hand if you were serving or lived. Yeah.
Still to support the Afghans so they can do it on their own.
Right. So it's more their fight with our help, right?
And then there's the CT mission, and which is unilateral.
Okay,
principally unilateral.
Yeah, so counterterrorism would be SIL, Delta, direct operations. The civilian from Finland, I believe, that was just kidnapped today, probably is very quickly, you know, being looked at in terms of the CT operation. The bombing and the campaign probably in Ningahar and Tora Bora region is CT, I would imagine. Drones, are drones CT?
Yeah.
And inside Afghanistan, the drone situation is different than in Pakistan or the border region. I've been out of government for a while, but I'm pretty sure that stayed the same. I put the quote here also from a Marine general, now a four-star, but he emailed me that when Fallujah had fallen. And he said, the number one lesson learned from Anbar, if you're going to go somewhere to support the people and gain their confidence and you're not going to stay, don't go. Do you agree with that or not? Who agrees with it? Just because the top general says it doesn't mean you need to agree. Pretty much agree with it.
Anywhere we've succeeded in that kind of a mission, it's been because we did stay. I mean, yeah. Germany post World War II, Japan post World War II.
Korea,
when we don't sign the SOFA in Iraq.
Yeah, so if you look at the strategy today, what's happening in Iraq and Afghanistan, have we said we're out of there? When President Obama, I opened one of my chapters with, you know, and we were all the press, and you were there. On December 1st, 2009 at West Point, President Obama made a big speech about the surge, right, escalation, and then the deadline. And a lot of historians, a lot of people smarter than I will write about that period. But it looks like we're now shifting back to the continuity approach. We'll see, because President Trump, what did President Trump say about nation building?
Nothing.
In the campaign?
Not in that business.
He was talking about here, right?
Yeah.
We need to rebuild our own country. So it'll be interesting to see, and I'll have a better feel for it later today, but it'll be interesting to see where things are going in terms of the campaign rhetoric that I think resonated with a lot of our fellow countrymen and women, and maybe some of the realities of just national security foreign policy. Maybe there's a mix, maybe General McNicholson won't get his troops, I don't know. Battle space owners, what do we mean by that?
The commander that owns the battle space that takes care of that area of operations.
Good. So the American commander that owns the battle space. Are there other battle space owners that we should think about? What about the Iraqis and the Afghans?
Yeah. There's interagency battle space owners.
And that's the worst battle space, is the interagency. But what the wars taught me is that, you know, this three-dimensional chessboard, and I'll fast forward here, really is more about their hands than ours. So any of you like Trekkie nerds?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Okay. So what is the prime directive in Star Trek?
Don't interfere.
Don't interfere.
Non-interfere.
Okay, I think you said it first. Yeah. So you get the book. Because sometimes I say that and no one wants to admit their Trekkie nerds. I did bring one paperback because the hardback's too heavy. But I like that you guys are all proudly like know what the prime directive is, because it's actually, I believe it. That one thing I learned in Fallujah, Hellman Host or whatever I was, is that even the U.S. hands, even hard power, even, I mean, now we had 10,672 Marines in 2009, and then Preston was 20,000 by the time we left. I love our Marine Corps. If you read my book, you'll see that. But even we have limits in terms of what we can do on the ground. And that the Trekkie mindset is actually a pretty healthy reminder that, you know, there are certain things that you can't change. So in Fallujah, I remember one example was, we were gonna bring in non-Fallujahs to police the city. And I remember thinking, but they've never been here before. It's like, I don't know, Preston, your hometown, so South Carolina? Is it Charleston?
Yeah.
Okay, so you talk about bringing Iraqis or Afghans into Charleston. You're like Denver or Leadville, Colorado will all be in 4 days. Like how quickly will they know what the heck's going on in a place like that? So in the wars, I used to say I understood 1% every year. And I barely believe that. It was more than Washington knew, but it was still very limited. But I think the prime directive is wise.